In this video, we'll go through the math for the PEC-GPS matrix inversion method. Let's dive in!
3, 2, 1, top.
3, 2, 1, half. The Flight Test Engineering Channel.
We start our data reduction with the correction for the instrument errors. So to our indicated airspeed, altitude, and temperature, we add whatever our instrument corrections are. Then we find the ratio QCIC over P0, starting from your airspeed, and also calculate the pressure ratio delta, starting from your indicated altitude. This is from your standard atmosphere. Then we can find QCIC over PS by multiplying QCIC over P0 times 1 over delta. To find the indicated Mach number, we then use your the keys QCIC over PS that we just calculated in this formula to get to our indicated Mach number. The total over static port pressure ratio, PT over PS, comes also from our indicated Mach number, but what we're going to do here is we're going to use our average between the three runs that we have to get one value of PT over PS. We're going to calculate what is the ambient temperature, considering what's your indicated temperature and your indicated Mach number. And then we can get the theta, which is your ambient temperature over T0. And from your theta and your indicated Mach number, you can calculate your indicated true airspeed. And this is going to be the input to our cloverleaf matrix inversion method. In this video, we'll build on what we saw on the first episode of this mini-series, where I used data from three different headings to calculate the wind and the airspeed error. This method is a little bit more forgiving with regards to variations in speed, and is preferred over the AC method. And I hear you ask, why isn't this suggested by the AC then? Well, because when the AC was published, methods to invert matrices and do iterative solutions were not readily available. As we saw in part 3, we start with flying at three different headings and gathering the data for our ground speed, ground track, and our indicated true airspeed, which are the quantities here in blue. And the unknowns that we have is, of course, the wind, the speed and direction of the wind. We don't know the error in our indicated and true airspeed. We don't know the direction that this error is imposing on our pitot system, and we don't know the true heading that we are flying. So we have this situation here where we have the three headings flown, the wind is constant throughout all the headings, but at the end of the day, we don't know a bunch of stuff. So from the wind triangle, what we have is that we know that ground speed equals our true airspeed plus wind. That's fine. And then we can explode our true airspeed into whatever indicated airspeed we have, true airspeed, plus a delta VT, which is the error that we're going to find. And from this equation here, we can isolate this term and write that VTI plus delta VT equals ground speed minus wind. And we have the following assumptions that are true as well for the previous method, that the true airspeed error is constant, so it doesn't vary between the runs. The wind is also going to be considered constant. There are no up and down drafts, so whatever wind we have is only purely horizontal. And that the true airspeed vector is parallel to the true airspeed error. They're aligned, meaning that the angle between these two vectors is 180. They're aligned. They are in the same line. So we are assuming that these are parallel, which enables us to write that the phi delta VT equals theta TI for each of the smaller vectors. So with these assumptions, we can write that delta VT for run number 1 equals delta VT for run number 2, which is equal for run number 3 as well. And since the two vectors are parallel, I mean, the true airspeed vector is parallel to its error vector, then we can write that these angles are the same. And this allows us for the magnitude of the true airspeed to be written as a pure number, not as a vector, meaning VTI plus delta VT. And then we can arrange the original vector equation as my true airspeed equals my ground speed minus wind now, instead of the opposite. And now we can start to decompose the vector equation into each of the vector components in the east and north direction. So this is the coordinate system that we will use throughout, right? So in here we can say that the east component of my true airspeed equals the east component of my ground speed minus the east component of my wind. And the north component of my true airspeed equals the north component of my ground speed minus the north component of my wind. And we also know how to calculate the east and north components from the ground speed because we already have ground speed and ground track from the GPS. So V ground east is going to be our ground speed times the sine of our ground track, and same for the cosine for the north. And then we can use Pythagoras on the true airspeed and get this. So our true airspeed squared is going to be the square sum of the true airspeed east plus the north. And we can substitute this back. So true airspeed equals indicated true airspeed plus our error. True airspeed east equals ground speed east minus wind east, and same thing for the north. And we substitute back in Pythagoras and we get this term here, VT squared. It's this term squared. So VTI squared plus delta VT squared equals V ground east minus V wind east squared plus V ground north plus V wind north squared. And now we can expand this squares here. So we get VTI squared plus 2 VTI delta VT plus delta VT squared. That's that term. V ground east squared minus 2 V ground east V wind east plus V wind east squared. That's that term. And this is the term for the north components. We can then, using this equation, group the terms as follows. So 2 VTI plus delta VT times VT delta VT. So it's this term there. We just take the delta VT and make it a common term. Same thing here, 2 ground speed east minus 2 minus V wind east on the outside. Same thing for the north. And on the other side, we are going to keep V ground east squared, V ground north squared. And then we pass VTI squared over to the right side. But we know that the square of the components, the sum of the square of the components is the square of ground speed as well. Same thing that we applied for Pythagoras. So we can substitute this portion here for VG squared, V ground squared. And then we can write this equation for each of the three runs. So VTI for the first run, delta VT, which is the same for all three runs. Remember, we're assuming that it is constant. V ground east 1, V ground north 1. And for the wind, we are keeping it constant again because we are assuming constant wind throughout all the three runs. So we write it for all the three runs here. And then we can write these three equations in a matrix form, which is this. 2 VTI 1 plus delta VT. 2 VTI VG1 minus V wind east, 2 V ground north 1 minus V wind north times this vector here, which is the vector of unknowns that we want to find out, delta VT and the wind components. And that's going to be equals another vector here, which is the square of V ground minus the indicated true airspeed squares. And we can think of this matrix equation here in this form, A times X equals C. So this is going to be A times vector X equals another matrix C. Or we can say that X equals A inverse times C, right? But there's a catch here because the elements of A depend on the variables we're trying to solve. So the elements of A here, delta V, depend on the variables, delta VT, delta V wind east, and V wind north. So again, V wind east and V wind north. They're all spread into the terms of our matrix A. So you can't just invert it and then multiply by C and get your results, because you don't know what's the content here. So how do you do this? Well, you approach it with an iterative solution. You guess first that your solution is a trivial, 0, 0, 0, for delta VT, V wind east and V wind north. You calculate the matrix A, invert, calculate the multiplication, and get these values here as an output. And then you feed it back in. Now that you know these values from the first calculation, you run it through again and again and again until convergence is reached. And once you have your wind speeds in the two directions, then it's easy to get your full wind direction by again applying Pythagoras. And for the wind direction, it's what we saw already, that we cannot apply the arctangent directly, because that's going to result in the wrong quadrant. So we need to correct by adding 2 pi first for to the arctangent that we calculate, and then mod 2 pi, which is the remainder when you divide by 2 pi. Once you have delta VT as well, you can calculate what is the true airspeed from your indicated plus your error. And remember, we have 3 values for our indicated airspeed, but it's fair to assume that it's constant, and it's fair to get the average of our indicated airspeeds to calculate our true airspeed, because we are assuming that you don't vary your indicated airspeed throughout the test points. Then we're going to go for temperature, because we want ultimately to calculate what is the Mach error. So to calculate our ambient temperature, we use again our indicated temperature, but in average for the 3 passes, times our recovery factor. And now that we have our true airspeed, because we know the error, we can add in this factor. We calculate then the temperature ratio, ambient temperature over T0. And then we can calculate what is the delta MPC directly with this formula, which is going to be our delta VT divided by speed of sound square root of theta. And then the truth Mach number is going to be the average Mach number for each of the runs plus this delta that we have here. From the truth Mach number, we can calculate the total pressure over ambient pressure, PT over PA, 1 plus 0.2 Mach squared to the 7/2. And finally, we're going to get the position error ratio, delta PS over PS, which is the goal of this data reduction, with this formula here. Thank you for watching this content, and I'll see you in the next video, where we're going to code it in Python. See you there!